Ecclesiastes chapter number 11, verse number 9. Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse number 9. Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth. Let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth. And walk in the ways of thine heart and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring you into judgment. Therefore, remove sorrow from thy heart and put away evil from thy flesh, for childhood and youth are vanity. Verse 1 of chapter 12. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. I want to preach tonight on the 10 biggest problems young people face. The 10 biggest problems young people face. Please pray and listen. I did a little research and I got some ideas from the study that I did. But this is my list. I read other people's lists and it included some of these, obviously. But I'm going to give you my list that I put together according to importance. In other words, the most important one will be first. The least important, 10, in my opinion. If you had to arrange these, you might, with good reason, arrange them a little bit different than I do. But I'm going to take number 10 and start and then go down. And the more the numbers go down, the more I feel like is the more dangerous for the young person. So what I'm saying is, when we get down to number 1, that will be the most dangerous, evil thing that young people face. We'll start out with the top, and I'm going to use these numbers here tonight and go down. Read them off to you very quickly. This here, number 10. Number 10. What would be the 10th thing on the list that y'all got to worry about and that the devil would use against young people, especially you 7th and 8th and 9th graders and teenagers? And that would be uncertainty about the future. You hear it on the news, you hear it all the time. As a matter of fact, you hear a lot of young people when they commit suicide and things like that say, I have no future. I have nothing to look forward to. I have nothing is going to work out. By the time I get a job this way, by the time the economy's bad, blah, 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 you know, on and on and on. We used to build things here in America, and now we understand that it's all gone, most of it, to foreign countries. And they're building our stuff, our cars, our furniture, making our clothes in other countries. And a lot of young people today grow up with, what am I going to do? That's why you hear about all these college graduates living in their parents' basements. And there's a lot of them like that. Can't find a job. And because the economy and the situation of our country is so bad, there's a hopelessness in the future that bothers a lot of young people. That's where a lot of those protesters come from. These college-educated people who are just mad because you don't just give them every little thing they want. If you want them to stop protesting, just throw a job application in the middle of them. But they hear about wars, hear about famines in the world, and disease, and they are the first generation ever that will be projected to earn less money than their parents. That's not a very bright outlook for many young people tonight. So that is uncertainty about the future. What's going to happen? How will it be 10 years from now? How will it be 20 years from now? Preacher, that bothers me. That's definitely a problem. But let me say all that tonight. Number 9. What would number 9 be? The second on the list, and the number 9 would be this. My answer is materialism. And that means that our generation of young people have so much material things without having to work for it, and it creates a sense of entitlement that we deserve. I hear them on TV saying everybody deserves a place to live and food to eat and free health care, and that is simply not true. No other generation in history has had the material things that you kids have. And that's why girls grow up and cannot cook. Girls grow up now thinking biscuits grow on a biscuit bush, and you wait till they're ripe and go out and pick them out off the bush and put them in the oven and heat them up in the microwave. And that's how you, honestly, they have no idea. I told them one day, I said, everything you eat comes from the ground. And they said, really? Really? Yes, it does. Everything you put in your mouth comes out of this ground. And you say, well, I drink milk. Cows eat the grass, and the grass makes the milk in the cow, and when the cow dies, it goes back to the ground. Everything you eat comes from the ground. And if we don't have farms, and we don't have people growing stuff, and people, oh, Lord have mercy, that's why they're trying to get everybody in the cities and the suburbs so that they'll depend on the government. People can't even make their own living no more. It's starved to death. If people had to make their own living anymore like people used to. Can't clean, don't know how. You take some, I hope all you girls ain't like this, but you take some of these teenage girls and take them in the bathroom and say, clean that bathroom. And they don't know. They look around and say, how? I thought, well, you might start by getting a sponge or a soapy rag or something and spraying something in the shower and scrape. See all that old junk on the shower, that old dead skin and black. Listen, if you know why you live like that? Because your mama lets you think it's okay. If you marry somebody that lets a house look like a dog pen, it's because their mama petted them rotten and never made them do no housework. Then you got to live with it. I'm telling you tonight, they don't know how to clean a stove. They don't know how to clean out a refrigerator. They don't know how to a refrigerator and stuff falls out on you. There's sometimes you got to go through it and throw stuff away. There's sometimes you got to go in your bathroom and put it. My mom always said, find a place for everything. Find a place for everything. I'm not very good at it. That's what she believed and taught. And ladies and gentlemen, I mean these boys, Lord have mercy, they don't know how to run a lawnmower. They don't know how to run a weed eater. They don't know how to run a chainsaw. They don't listen. When I was going to school, there wasn't no such thing as $200 tennis shoes. There was no such thing as braces. If you had crooked teeth, you just had crooked teeth, brother. And I mean, if something's wrong with you, you just lived with it. I mean, it wasn't everybody gets a trophy. Everybody's a star. Everybody's a movie star. Everybody has Air Jordan. Our tennis shoes cost about $5. Converse All-Star in today's money might be $20. And brother, we is happy to get it. Our blue jeans cost less than $10. They didn't have to be designer jeans. You didn't spend $100 on a pair of blue jeans. I mean, Lord, you kids here, you think you've got to have a phone. And if you don't, you're pitiful and you're poor. You got to have an iPad. And then you got to have this. And you've got to go get a massage. Or you've got to go get your nails done. And you've got to go get... that's one of the things that's killing young people. That's why they won't work. I mean, take some of these boys. We had them out here and we was cutting these weeds. And they work about 15 minutes and sit down and say, how tired I am. Listen, when I went to school, there was boys that wanted to play basketball and could not be on the basketball team because their daddy needed them on the farm every evening. They couldn't play. They couldn't play. They had to come in and feed horses and pigs and milk cows and bale hay and everything else. And now we think they've just got to, we got to have them to this game and we got to have them to this game and we got to cater to every little old thing they want. I'm telling you, materialism is killing our generation of young people. I'm glad we got things, but Lord, when we was growing up, we didn't have an iPad. I didn't have we had a tire swing. How many of y'all ever had a tire swing? You take an old tire, put a rope around it, find an old limb that's going out like that, and somebody climbs up the tree and ties the rope, and you get in that tire and swing. You poor little old pitiful kids that thinks it's terrible if you get your fingernails dirty. That's why some of you boys are so sissified. Say amen right there. Brother, we'd play King of the Hill. Somebody King of the Hill and throw dirt clods at them until you knocked them down. And then that person was King of the Hill until you got up there and slung them down.
Buddy, when we come in, our clothes was red with that red dirt, mud, and hoppy tom. I'm kill a snake. Every boy ought to know how to kill a snake. Kill a snake, boys. Oh, mama, mama, there's a snake. There's something wrong with you, boy. Amen. Something wrong with you. Amen. Girls, learn how to fix a pan of biscuits, even if it's hypocrite biscuits. Hypocrite biscuits, then you buy the can, just go pop and open them up like that. Surely you can learn how to fix them. Amen. Hey, boys, you know what we used to do? Arm wrestle. Guy, get over there. Guy, get over here. Arm wrestle. You know how to do that? That's what you need to learn. Learn how to go fishing. Learn how to pull a hook out of a fish's mouth and take half his guts out with it when you do it. Amen. Look, you ain't going to like this, and people on the internet will get mad at me, but you boys, you ought to know how to shoot a .22 rifle. You ought to know how to shoot a rifle. I ain't had a gun all my life. I ain't never shot nobody. Just criminals and crazy people shoot people. Listen, brother, guns are learn how to shoot at a target. Learn how to shoot a bow and arrow. Daddy bought me a bow and arrow one time when I was about that tall. And, buddy, I got good with that thing. I thought I was William Tell. I learned how to, and this is no lie. It's no lie. I've made a few great shots in my life, and this is one of the greatest. I'll tell you about some of the other ones one of these days. But about that one time my sister said, or somebody said, there's a snake. And there's a snake going across our driveway. And I was up in the yard. I was about as far as from here to the back door, the glass door going outside. And I come around the house, and I went like this, and went like that on the run and pulled it back and nailed that snake with that arrow. Went right through him. I kid you not. I said, I got him, Daddy. And, buddy, that thing crawled off down through the weeds with that arrow stuck right through it. And I went down there and pulled it out. And I said, listen, boys, you need to learn how to do that. Learn how to learn how to kill a spider with your bare hands. You going to be a transgender? Lord, no! Hey, listen, brother. Learn how to ride a horse. Learn how to shoot a slingshot. You boys ever had a slingshot? Get your daddy to cut you a piece of wood. Looks like it right there. Put two pieces of rubber on, pull it back, and shoot rocks right through your neighbor's window. No, don't do that. No, don't do that. I'm telling you, brother, learn how to be a boy. Learn how to play. Learn how to get dirty. Get in the mud. Girl, learn how to sweep the floor, girls. Here's the way you're going to have to do in your house. I'm trying to get to the bathroom. It's back here somewhere if I can find the door. That's where you're going to be if you don't learn how to sweep. Jackhammer couldn't get that dirt, that food off them dishes been laid in that sink 3 or 4 weeks. That's materialism. Number 8. On our countdown tonight. You know what's killing our generation of young people? Growing up too fast. Say amen, parents. Amen. Now you parents, every one of you, are going to have to deal with this. It's so sad what they are seeing and knowing and doing at such a young age. Little bitty girls. 8 and 9. It's horrible. Painting up lipstick and eyeshadow and all kinds of makeup. I've seen them this high with big old thick lipstick and high heels. And the devil is trying to take every one of those little girls and make them look like a street walking hooker so that the world will disrespect them. And brother, pedophiles are having a heyday and our little girls tonight. Listen, let a little girl be a little girl. Let her be a girl until she gets big enough to be a woman. Don't try. Good Lord, it's terrible what women are taking. I think this dance mom business, this dance mom baloney, brother, I think it's child abuse. Take them little old girls out there and push them, and they're out there twisting their hips and their body, trying to act sexual, and at 9 and 10 and 11 years old, and a world full of perverts out there looking at them cheerleaders and everything else. I'm telling you tonight, they're growing up too fast. Let them be little while they're little. They don't need to be a ballerina when they're 9. They don't even get to be kids anymore. 10-year-old ain't got no business wanting to wear a miniskirt. Or a 16-year-old, for that matter. They say that 8 to 12-year-olds, this is hard to believe, but the statistics say 8 to 12-year-olds have $43 billion a year of their own spending money. And buddy, the world's cashing in on that money. Birthday money, allowances, just money people give kids. You know what we call that? Corporate pedophilia. When we was growing up, Judy Garland was on the Wizard of Oz, and she would sing, "Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue." You know, and she had a little dress. Dun, 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 dun. And now look what we got. Now look what we got. As role models, our kids, Katy Perry saying, "California Girl," and every little girl in junior high knows it word for word. So I'm telling girls how to be a prostitute. They're bombarded with stuff way before they should be hearing things like that. These kids nowadays know and talk about stuff some people didn't even know. They've been married several years. Sickening. Pitiful. I'll say tonight as I move on, Miley Cyrus, Amanda Bynes, 10 to 12-year-old mothers is what we're winding up with. Many a woman are obsessed with their daughter because they messed around and got old and fat too quick, and they want to live their dream through that little girl. Amen. And they're trying to make, "Oh, I want you, honey, and I want you, honey, and you blow your hair dry, and I want you to, oh, you look so cute. Go, baby, go, baby, go, baby." And they're trying to live their unfulfilled dream through their little girl, and they're ruining that kid, pushing them toward boy. "Oh, I think he likes you. I think he likes you. Honey, go talk to him." That is one mother that ought to have a room in a nut house. Number seven. You know what's killing you tonight, kids? You know what's hurting every young person in here tonight? The erosion of our national pride and identity. Years ago, kids were taught who we are and where we came from and what we're doing here. Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, we are in the United States of America. We have a country. We belong to this country. We are Americans. We live here. This is our heritage. This is our country. It's not perfect. It's a long way from it. But we need our national pride. We ought to be thanking God that we live in this country. You know what we used to do at school? Every morning we'd go in, we'd say, "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." And it gives us a sense of identity. We live here in America. This is our country. But, buddy, we have a generation. Some of you people probably sitting in here tonight, "Oh, I don't even believe in all that old pride stuff." Well, you move to Russia, brother. Move. Go to Iran. Go with them. There's all these people talk about how hard we are on homosexuality and stuff. You know what they do to homosexuals in Iraq? Kill them. They are executed. You're a bunch of hypocrites. Basketball players go over there in them other countries and play and won't come to Charlotte because we got a law that talks about bathroom. I'm telling you, they're trying to get our kids. You mamas and daddies better wake up. They're trying to get our kids. They're trying to ruin our boys and our girls. I'm telling you, we ought to thank God for our country. Pray for our leaders. Pray for our president. Pray for the senators and the congressmen. Pray for our governor. Pray for our police. Pray for our school teachers. Pray for our pastors and churches. We ought to have a little national pride back again. Amen. They joke now and make fun of anybody who is a patriotic in any way. The Constitution, the Mayflower Compact, every bit of that was built on the Word of God, the King James Bible. We ought to try to achieve, we ought to raise the bar, go above and beyond for our families and our friends. Amen. Let me say this about immigration. Anybody in the world who wants to come to America legally and peacefully should be welcome to come. Right? If you disagree with that, you're a mean person. You should. Anybody wants to come legally and agreeably and peaceably, fine. Don't matter where they are from. It don't matter what their religion is. It don't matter what color their skin. It's got nothing to do with it. If you come legally and peacefully, if you come illegally or here to hurt somebody or kill, you should not be allowed to come in this country. You know what that's called? Common sense. We're killing ourselves in this country by letting a bunch of liberals. You know why the Democrats and liberals want all the immigrants in? To vote them back in when voting time comes. You don't take a genius to figure that out. It's votes. I didn't plan on saying that, but you got that in there for free. Our colleges, Yale, Harvard, Princeton, every one of them was started by people that believe the Bible to be the Word of God. Number six. Coming down now. Number six, quickly. Educational disparity or problems at school. Nobody here that's been to school can say you have not had problems at school. The problems in our schools today are absolutely scary. When we went to school, there was no such thing as school shootings. Now, just in the last 10 years, I think over 200 kids have been murdered at school. At school. We'd have never thought about it. Boys used to come and bring their shotgun to school in the back of their pickup truck, leave it out there all day, wasn't even locked, and is going squirrel hunting after school that day. You say, well, I can't imagine that. It's hard to imagine now. You see what our world's turned into? You know what started stuff like that? Rock and roll videos, the culture, the drugs. You say, I don't believe that. That's because you hadn't done your homework. You don't remember the Pearl Jam video of about 15 years ago when it came out with a video called Jeremy. And Jeremy's a little kid about that high who comes in and starts shooting up his teacher and kills everybody in the class. Every kid in the country watched that video and had that ingrained in their head and in their mind. Nobody never thought about doing nothing like that when we went to school. Ladies and gentlemen, educational disparity. I thank God for our teachers, Brother Mike, Alicia, and others, Megan and others that have taught in our school. Thank God we still got some Christians in there trying their best to do the right thing. Hallelujah! Praise God. But brother, the bullying and stuff like that is absolutely out of control. Almost every kid has been the object of bullying. I'm sure all you kids in here know exactly what I'm talking about. You say, what makes kid bully? The depravity of the human heart. We're naturally bent towards sin. Boys hit and torture other young boys. When I went to school, they picked on us. Big boys picked on little boys. Seniors picked on freshmen. I remember they'd take their school class ring, turn it around like that so the big part would be down here. And if a freshman came down there and said, how you doing, buddy? Bam! Pop you in the head with that thing. I've been popped in the head with it, and I popped a couple. When I got bigger or older, I never did get bigger. But I finally got big enough, old enough to get me a ring. And ladies, that's wrong. You say, what makes boys do like that? Full of the devil. They're full of the devil. Let me tell you about a young man by the name of Daniel. He was bullied at school. I think he's around 14 or 15. They punched him in the stomach. Some boys gathered around him and made him stick his tongue on the bus window when it's cold one day. They threw trash on him. And they jumped him from behind, walking to get on the school bus. He told them, and he tried to be friends with them. He'd send out a message on his computer and say, why are you mean to me? I stay out of your way. I don't try to hurt you. But they didn't like him because he was different than they were. He sort of liked to hunt and fish, and there was all these cool hip-hop sort of cool cats, and they thought he's some weirdo country bumpkin, you know, and they picked on him. And every time he'd go by, when boys just hit him like that or something like that, he's scared to go to the bathroom in school because he'd get beat on. And they did beat on him. And one day they beat him up real bad. And some of the boys would say, we're going to get you at school, and gather around him. And finally, one of them sent a text out. They still got that text, and it said, why don't you just take a gun and do the world a favor and get rid of yourself? And Daniel sent a text back and said, you won't have to worry about me again. I'm going home
and kill myself. And he told his best friend, he said, I'm going to kill myself. And when he went home that day, his mom had took his brother to a ball game. Mom and dad gone to a ball game. And while they were at the ball game, somebody called them and said, you better check on Daniel. He's threatened to commit suicide. And they didn't check their phone and didn't get that message during that game. And somebody called, phone rang, but Daddy's watching the ball game and didn't answer his phone. When they got out, they had message on their phone. You better check. So they rushed home, run in the house, come up the step, and the sight they saw in the bedroom was horrible. Daniel was laying in a pool of his own blood where he took a shotgun and blew his brains out. And they cried and said, why? Why'd you do that? Why'd you do that? And they found the text that he sent. You won't have to worry about me anymore. You parents, that's how bad this stuff's got. If we knew some of the kids right here that dread going to school tomorrow because of what they might face. Brings me to my next point, number five. Depression. Depression is very common among teenagers, especially girls. Girls are like four times as likely to fall into depression as boys. Psychiatrists and psychologists can't figure that out, but any Bible believer with any sense in the Bible knows exactly why that is. Girls are different than boys. No matter how you try to make us the same, we're not the same. We're not made the same. We're not created the same. We don't think the same and ain't supposed to. Very common. You get irritable, stomach pains. You withdraw, peer pressure. You break up with your boyfriend. You get in a fight with your mama. Something bad happened. Your best friend goes off with other people and don't have nothing to do with you. You see, when you're 15, 16, 17, everything is a big deal. I mean, every little old thing that you go through, it's like the end of the world. After you get older, you get your feelings hurt. You just sort of take it and go on. But when you're young, and your boyfriend breaks up with you and you're 13, you think the world's ended and you'll never have any chance of being happy again. And the devil just jumps on you. Parents, fight, drugs, self-esteem, everything's awful. That's why suicide is skyrocketing. Also, we can thank our little girl rock singers, Katy Perry and Kesha and them for singing songs like, we're gonna die young, we're gonna die young. Don't you listen to fools like that. Listen, they're led by the devil. They're led by the devil. Ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you the answer to depression. The Bible said the joy of the Lord is your strength. You get happy in Jesus, get your heart right with God, have the glory of God bubbling up in your soul. You don't have to go around depressed all the time. Number four, social media. We're getting close down to the end now. Tammy, a 13-year-old girl, was found dead the other day, had been murdered, and had been secretly messaging this boy who was over 18, and back and forth and back and forth, and finally snuck out of the house one night to meet him. They had been sending messages back and forth. He said, meet me somewhere. And she said, no. She's sort of scared. Listen, girls. She said, meet me. She wouldn't. Meet me. She wouldn't. Now, there's something in you girls that loves a boy to want you. You're naturally made that way. But what you don't understand is the devil's out here like a roaring lion trying to ruin your life. She went out and met him one time. Teenage girls listening, they found her body 80 miles away. She stabbed to death. Raped and stabbed to death. You don't know who you're talking to on that computer. You don't know even if they send a picture.
And by the way, kids, remember this. Anything you put out there, it's always out there. You can't never get it back. You send a text, you send a picture, it never, ever comes back. I know of a teenage girl right now. Somebody in school sent her a picture of another girl in school. I don't know how they got it. It was started out as a joke in a locker room or something, but they took a picture of this girl with no clothes on, and it was sort of a joke, and sent it to this other girl. And she laughed and said, "Oh my God, I can't believe that. I can't believe that." And they laughed about it, and she sent it to one person, her best friend. She said, I didn't send it to nobody else, just my best friend. And guess what? Her best friend sent it to somebody else. And the next thing you know, it was all over the high school that there was naked pictures of this girl on everybody's phone. And they found out and called them into the principal's office. And this young girl, who was innocent of except she sent it to one person. And they called them in there, and they had the police in that principal's office. And they talked to every one of them kids, and they said, "We could charge every one of you right here for distribution of child pornography. You can be charged a federal crime that'll be on your record the rest of your life, and you will have to register as a sex offender. Rest of your life. You don't have, listen, if somebody sends you a dirty picture, erase the picture and delete whoever that was. They are not your friend. That's a devil trying to send that to you. I'll guarantee you, there's some of you sitting right here tonight that is so dumb, you got dirty pictures on your phone right now. Let's see your phone. Let's everybody in here pick your phone up here and let's see what's on it. You say, "Oh my goodness, I can't believe that." Listen, you don't mess around and get yourself arrested. Social media. The other day, some men, these guys, did an experiment. They did it to try to teach this girl a lesson. Grown men, this teenage girl, she was pretty, cheerleader, and they begin to send her messages saying, "Will you meet me somewhere?" They said, "I'm Greg," or something, and he messaged her, and she messaged him back, and he messaged her, and she messaged him back, and they began to talk back and forth. He said, "Please meet me, please meet me." And she said no for 2 or 3 days, and finally, he said, "Meet me at Starbucks." And she said, I'll meet you at Starbucks after cheerleading practice. After cheerleading, she thought, this is harmless. You watch them stupid shows on MTV and all them shows, you know, and Teen Mom and blah, blah. Every bit of that stuff is to push you. They make stars out of a teen mother who's messed up her life to try to make you think that's normal and it's okay. Make her a movie star. See what the devil's doing? And she met this guy at Starbucks, and he said, "Well, what do you like to do?" And she said, I don't know. She said, "I'm a cheerleader." He said, "What do you like to do?" And she said, "I like to bowl." He said, "Hey, you want to go bowling? I love to bowl." And she said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, you want to go bowling?" She said, "Sure, let's go." I mean, that seems harmless. Nothing wrong with going bowling. How harmless that is? She said, "Okay, let's go." And you know what? They went out in the parking lot. And she said, "My car's right over here. I'll just meet you at the bowling alley." He said, no, let's take mine." She said, "No, my car's fine. And they said, "No, well, let's take mine." And finally, he said, "My truck's right here." And she said, "Oh, my goodness, is that your truck?" And he said, "Yeah, hop in." She said, "Oh, I love that truck." He said, "Well, just come on." And she broke down. And when she started to get in that truck, 3 of his friends come around from the parking lot. One of them grabbed her like this. The other grabbed her hand. She was trying to scream. They opened up the back of that truck and threw her in there. She screamed, "Help! Help! Please! Help!" And about that time, she heard a voice in there and called her name. And it was her best friend. And she said, "We've done this to teach you a lesson." And she said she thought she was dead. She thought she was dead. She thought she's dead. And it was a trick to teach her a lesson. You hear me? Their role models today are terrible. God help us. Number three. Drugs, alcohol.
That's on my important of my estimation of importance.
I hesitate to say drugs and alcohol. Alcohol is a drug. Ladies, don't say, well, he don't. I got to tell him one time, he said, my son never used drugs, and he drinks all the time. You drink alcohol, you use drugs. Amen? If you don't like that, go start your church and preach whatever you want to. I'm telling you, the book said, wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. You got any sense, you'll leave that stuff alone. You won't sneak over and try to get a glass of wine. You won't sneak over and try to drink a beer. You know what? I'll tell you about a young boy who was 17. He turned into a coke addict, cocaine addict, and heroin. When he's 17, and they interviewed him and said, son, you got a good home. You got a family that loves you. You've got nice clothes. What in the world made you become a drug addict? He said, when I was 13, I smoked pot for the first time, and I drank beer. Pot is always a door to harder and worse drugs. It's just like going in the front door. The rest of it's in there waiting. And they said, why'd you do it? He said, out of curiosity. You know why kids drink? They're curious and they want to be cool like everybody else. You see these other guys do it and think, man, that's cool. I'm going to try that. And then they go out, and by the time they get in college, let me give you some statistics right quick. We'll move along. Amen? By age 14, listen, parents, by age 14, 20% of kids smoke cigarettes, and 65% of them have tasted alcohol. 65%! Don't you sit there and say, my child would never do that. Your child made out of the same stuff my kids and Charles Manson made out of. Flesh! Flesh, don't think it. You say, well, I've had them in church all their life. That's no guarantee. 25% have done binge drinking. That means they get them stupid little bong thing or a big time like that, and they let somebody just pour beer down their throat because they feel like how fast it can hit their system and how it's like to get drunk. Don't you know you're becoming an alcoholic? And don't you know that'll destroy you? The Bible says strong drink is raging. Leave it alone. Alcohol is of the devil, kids. Alcohol's of the devil. It's liquid devil. Beer, wine, liquor, gin, whiskey, any white lightning, it's of the devil. It's of the devil. Leave it alone. Don't touch it. Don't fool with anybody that drinks. Don't go nowhere with anybody that drinks. They say that your chances of drinking, using drugs, are like 50 times more if you hang around people that does it. 25% of all 12th graders get high on a regular basis. 40% of all 12th graders drink alcohol. Boys lose football career. We all know boys that had tons of talent that probably could have played professional. There's thousands of young men out there in New York City and Atlanta and Charlotte and everything that probably could have played basketball or football as good as any pro out there, but the drugs or alcohol, they're like it destroyed their career. We all know boys that make good money, have plenty of talent, plenty of smart, but they don't never have nothing. Their homes are wrecked. Their lives are wrecked. They can't keep a job. They can't keep a relationship. Can't keep a husband or a wife because of drugs. Drugs will cost you everything. Drugs will destroy your life. Are you listening to me? Drugs will destroy your life. Don't touch it. You say, well, I don't want them to call me. Let them call you anything. Call me whatever they want to. They can call me chicken. Call me weirdo. Brother, the Lord calls you wise. Whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Leave it alone. Most teenagers know where drugs are and how to get them. Number two. Before the last one, number two. the devil is doing to destroy your life is the breakdown of the home. Amen. Mom and daddy both not being in the home. You say, you put that ahead all at us? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. If you had a young man, stand up here, Brother Derek, right here in the middle, you and Shaughnessy, right there. Come here a minute, Austin. Help me here a minute. Just stand right here. All right, let's y'all get here and have him stand in the middle. Now, y'all reach hands around him. Around him. There you go, both hands. That's the way home is. That's the way home is when mom and daddy's both in the home. And see, if I'm the devil, I try to get him here. Daddy's got me. I try to get him here. Mama's praying with him. I try to get him here, but mama leave. She can leave and sit down. Now what's the devil going to do? He's got him. He's got him. And if daddy's gone, the devil really got him. You ought to heard, you can sit down. Listen, you ought to heard what we was talking about last night of the statistics. You know, in Burke County right now, there's, I think they said, over 200 kids in foster care in this town right here. 200! Amen. And a big percentage of the kids that wind up in foster care wind up in prison. The breakdown of the family. There is nothing in this world that can protect a child like mama and daddy praying with it at night, taking it to church. I'm talking about daddy walking in the house of God and sitting down there with his Bible and mama walking behind him and praying with that kid at night. And sitting there, they did a survey and they said, people who eat supper together more than twice a week, the chances are like 10 times less for their kid to get out and get in trouble. Just eating supper together every evening. Breakdown of the home. The devil sees mom and daddy split. 28 million kids are living in this country with either one parent or neither. And if you're in that situation, ain't nothing you can do about it. Do the best you can. I know I've been there. It ain't easy. It ain't easy being a mama and a daddy. But I'm telling you, you better pray and you better protect them. I heard about a girl some time ago. This man, he was a businessman in town. And he kept his wine in his wine cellar. And he kept his wine in the house there where everybody, you know, where he could have his little drink at night and with supper and wouldn't let his kids run it because he was underage. And he was like a businessman or like a politician in that town. And one day, his 16-year-old daughter was out with some boys that come around a curve and wrecked a car and killed them, killed that girl. And the police called. And they said, you better come down there. And he come down there, and he found out his daughter was dead. He went wild with rage. He said, I'll kill that boy that's driving that car. He said, I'll find the man that give her that alcohol, and I'll choke him to death. I'll kill him with my hand. If I ever find out who give my daughter alcohol. He went home. Next night, he was so nervous, he said he went to the cabinet to get him a drink. And in that cabinet, he found a note from his daughter. Said, Dear Dad, we're taking along some of your wine. We didn't think you'd care. Signed his daughter. His own alcohol killed his daughter. I'm telling you tonight, boys and girls, if you've got a mama and a daddy sitting here tonight, thank God for them. Thank God for them. Respect them. Do right, sir. Thank God every day of your life for your mama and your daddy. Number one, this is it. You say, Brother Danny, you have covered everything we can think of that destroys young people. You've talked about national pride and drugs and alcohol and peer pressure and bullying and movie stars and everything. Is there something worse than that? Yeah, they are. This is it, number one. The number one thing the devil's using to kill off young people today is dead churches. Dead churches. Terrible. Terrible. You ask a kid to come to church and they go, it's so boring. It's so dead. It's so dry. Listen, our church, a real church ain't dead, and a real church ain't dry, and a real church ain't boring. I told some boys over at the gym one day, I said, listen, real church is the most exciting, most wonderful thing in this world. It is the closest thing to heaven you can get in this world is a real old-fashioned Holy Ghost church service. And listen, boys and girls, you need to realize when you go to the house of God, this thing is real. There's a real heaven. There's a real hell. There, Jesus is coming back, and you're going to stand before God, and every one of you is going to heaven or hell. Every one of you. It is the worst child abuse that you can commit to teach a kid or live like there's no hell. That's the worst child abuse you can commit, is to teach a kid there's no hell. There's a hell, y'all. There's a hell. Day before yesterday, I believe it was, I was ironing a shirt. And I set the iron down and reached over it to get the starch. And when I did, that iron just barely touched my arm right there. I jerked my arm like that. And I pulled my arm back. And I went in the bathroom and I took some of that stuff you put on sunburn, you know, that aloe stuff there, and I rubbed it on it. And my arm burned for hours. And I burned for hours. Do you hear me? I burned. And I burned. And I left a little mark right there. That's one little touch of an iron. You imagine fire in your nose, in your eyes, all over your body. Not for an hour, not for a day, but forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. You say, well, you shouldn't scare kids. Is it true? If it's true, it's a crime not to tell them. If it's not true, shut the doors and turn the lights out. We ain't got no right to call ourselves a church if the Bible ain't true. If it's true, it's a crime not to tell them. I know people say, oh, little boys and girls shouldn't be told that. If it's true, they should. They ought to be told there's a hell as soon as they're able to understand it. You don't want to go there. I'm glad I'm not going to hell. I'm glad I'm not going to hell. The most important thing in the world is not being head cheerleader, is not being captain of the football team, is not making a lot of money or being popular. The most important thing in the world is being saved and missing hell when you die. That's number one, y'all. Number one, getting saved, get right with God. You know what the world would call me tonight? We'll get letters on this. We'll get letters on this. You shouldn't scare little children like that. Here's what your Bible says. The Bible said it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. The Bible said by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. Anybody that's not scared of hell is crazy. Crazy. There's a hell. There's a hell. When you go there, you burn forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. I don't apologize for saying that. It's in this book. In that book. Your parents all appreciate that. If you're a parent here tonight and say, I don't think kids should be told that, that shows how backslid and unbelieving you are. You don't even believe your own Bible. Cutters, skyrocketing. Emos, out the roof. Suicide, overdose on pills, unbelievable. When they go to God's house, they ought to say, here it is. Here's what life's all about. Something better than drugs is here. Come on, Sissy. Something better than liquor is here. Something better than illicit sexual activity is here. Something better than drugs are here. Something better than anything this world's got. Come get a hold of it tonight. Let's stand by our heads for prayer. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Christians are praying. Come on, kids. Come on, get in this altar tonight. Come on. Maybe you're here tonight and you've never been saved. You've never even been saved. Come on, get down here on your knees. That's right. Come on. That's right. Come on, Tina. Don't you wait on somebody else. Don't wait on somebody else. Come on.